now. Sometimes in this path, there can seem to be many frustrations, and it's very natural because what the master is asking us to do is actually impossible to do, you see? And then we can feel helpless about it. So, for example, if I tell you, don't do this, then you feel like I have to do that. And you say, okay, don't even do that. Then you say, but then, okay, I just have to stay here. But if I say, don't even do that, you see, then you may come up with some more, but I'm going to say, don't even do that, you see. So the thing is, we feel at a loss. We feel frustrated. We can feel angry. Like somebody was talking about Maharaja a while ago, and I remember reading I Am That before I met Guruji. And for a long time, I used to feel very frustrated, very angry. How to stay in the I Am for so long? I can't even do it for a few moments. He's talking about 3 years as if it's a short time. So all of this can get to us. So, but actually, and that is why I feel like saying more and more these days, that aspect of our being where we can do or we can understand, you see, just keep that aside. You see? Where we think we can do or we think we can understand, all of that is an idea in our mind. And I was saying to Brahm, I think last time, what about the rest of you? Over there we can have confusion, we can want clarity, we can want answers, you see. But what about the rest of you? Is the mind all of you? And when I'm saying mind, I'm not using the bigger definition. I'm using the smaller definition, which is a bundle of thoughts, you see. It is a bundle of thoughts. So besides the thoughts, you see, which you want to make coherent or you want to make conclusive, where you want to have some final answers, if you were to accept that finality is not possible there, because it itself, the seller of limitation itself is limited, you see, so it cannot fathom reality. You see, then what struggle is left? Okay. So if you don't try to understand, if you don't try to make sense of anything, how are you struggling? You may say, I'm struggling with some desire, I want something, but that is also in the same aspect, no? The mind aspect of our existence. So we feel like we have to construct our house there by collecting the best spirituality. And best spirituality is a bundle of ideas that we have about God or Self or the Absolute, as well as ideas about the experiences that we have been able to collect. You see, we feel like if we have enough of those, we have enough bricks to build that house. But we cannot build a house there. Everything that we build over there is changing, is going. You see? So don't construct anything there. And for a moment, we won't even try to deconstruct anything there. Now, Even to check on how you are, where will you go? Are you getting this? Where will you go to check that? You see? So to remain in the unborn is to not go to the birth of the mind. You see? And not go to the birth of the mind does not mean that the thought cannot arise, but the birth of the mind is to accept it to be true, accept it to be valid. When you think you know, you see, you don't actually know. And when you think you don't know, also you don't actually know. Then what is left? If you did not have to determine anything in your head today, what would be there? You see? Now, for the important stuff, presumably important stuff, you see, like your very existence or the existence of this plea, is that dependent on your thinking? You see? Now, independent of your mind, is everything not functioning? And again, I'm talking about the small mind, yes? Independent of your conceptualizing, independent of your judgment, independent of your notions, everything not in the light of natural existence continuing to play. So human arrogance or our mental arrogance is to presume that I can add to God in natural existence, add to beingness with my value-added ideas. You see? And what happened then, we all know. Most of us have experienced that enough, and we come to satsang after that. You see? And even if what I'm proposing to you is not true, even if, is it okay, but my life is going to be a mess if I let go, if I remain open and empty. It's worth at least some experimentation. We've tried it the other way for long enough, 30, 40, 50, 60 years, you see. So at least for a few weeks we can try, few days we can try. And then you will find, I guarantee you, that in your natural openness, in your emptiness, there is a supreme natural intelligence which continues to move whatever needs to be moved in this waking state. But you remain, you see, the same as what you are in the sleep state. That doesn't mean you're like sleeping and letting the world pass by. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that you remain undisturbed unshaken with the content of what may be appearing, and unshaken, undisturbed with the content of what may be appearing in this very body which you call me. Even that you are independent of. Now you may say, okay, fine, I cannot suffer this way. If I'm open and empty, suffering is to be closed, is to resist. Open and empty is the absence of suffering. But what about God? I came to spirituality to find God. When you are open and empty, that which you are looking for, whether you call it God or the Absolute, is completely apparent to you. Not as a distinct entity away from you, not even as yourself, you see, beyond any of these considerations. You see? So, open and empty is worth it because not only the recognition that you are looking for is fully available, but also the worldly struggle, problem, resistance, conditioning, we are empty of all of that. And if you do not want anything out of this, if you do not want anything out of this, then you will not get confused again. So, confusion is deeply linked to misidentification. In fact, the basis of all confusion is only who we are, who we think we are, and it is deeply linked to what we want.